It is time now to head into the chat room with Nine's Brady Halls in Sydney and broadcaster Katie Wolfe from Mix 104.9 in Darwin. Good afternoon to both of you.
G'day, Amber.
Hi, guys.
Now, first up today, notorious child killer Michael Guider, who killed Sydney schoolgirl Samantha Knight, has walked free from jail less than an hour ago, despite calls to keep him behind bars. A Supreme Court judge on Tuesday rejected an application to keep him in jail for another year, while the New South Wales Attorney General was advised an appeal will likely be unsuccessful. So all legal avenues to stop his release were exhausted. His victims' families say they are certain he will reoffend. Let's go first to you, Brady. Is there a problem with the system that we can't keep him locked up?
Yeah, look, I certainly think the family of Samantha Knight would say there is. You know, they were thinking a few years ago in New South Wales where Guider was convicted of murdering Samantha, and he pleaded guilty to that as well. There was a law they were playing around with a few years back to say, you know, if a murderer doesn't divulge where they place the body of their victim, then they don't get out of jail until they do. Now, Guider has said, of course, all the way along, he's forgotten. But I think the family might say, well, keep him in there to just jolt his memory and let's see what happens. You know, it's hardly showing contrition when you don't divulge to the family where the victim of the crime is. And, you know, these people can't move on with their life. Not that you totally move on, but at least get some peace and somewhere where they can grieve at a funeral site somewhere. South Australia has this law, and the Northern Territory is actually thinking about it as well because of the case of Peter Falconio, who was murdered by Bradley Murdoch, who never revealed what he did with Peter. And I know that the family of Peter would love to know where their son and brother's body is, and I'm sure Samantha Knight's mother feels exactly the same way.
Yeah, Katie, 23 years, I think it was, he was behind bars. He killed a little girl. He sexually assaulted countless others numerous times. Yeah. And he's now a free man, albeit for 5 years he's under quite restricted control, saying that they're giving him things like medication to suppress his libido. So they obviously think he's still a risk. What do you think?
I don't know that you can actually rehabilitate somebody that has done such disgraceful, disgusting things. And I know that that certainly when people are sent to jail, the whole aim is to try and rehabilitate them so that when they come out, if they come out, that they're better people. But I can't think of a better reason to keep somebody behind bars than this bloke. And Brady, the law that you're speaking of is the no body, no parole law. And I actually think that it is something that should be implemented Australia-wide. If you commit a heinous crime like this and you don't even have the guts to say where you've left that body, where you've left that person, their family is grieving, and it shows to me that you've got no real remorse for what you've done.
Yeah, I think it should go further. Like, if you kill a kid, I think you should go to jail for life. Like, I'm sorry.
I agree.
Children and police. Yep.
Right. And not only did he kill Samantha, he sexually assaulted her. There's dozens of other victims.
66.
And 66 so hundreds
charges.
Of people, when you include the families that are involved in this, whose lives have been ruined. They will never get their lives
back.
And yet he, in 5 years, after he's got these restrictions, will. And I just don't think that there's
Where's he gonna live?
And I think you'll speak to most people. I've talked to a lot of people in the newsroom, and everyone feels the same way. And it's outrageous that people, like the government, can't even step in when a Supreme Court judge goes, well, no, he's out. I think, the laws definitely need to change. And people are going to be nervous. They're going to be watching him. And if he does re-offend, then what, you know?
Well, that's exactly right. I mean, what needs to happen here? Does another child need to be sexually abused? Does something else need to happen before we realise that you've got to change these types of laws? I just don't think that you can let somebody like this out.
Yeah, and what financial cost to the community too? I mean, the monitoring this man 24/7, 7 days a week for who knows how many years is a big burden to all of us.
All right, let's move on. A little bit lighter note. A group in Brisbane are lobbying for more public spaces to be created for dogs, saying that as people are forced into apartment living, there needs to be more pet-friendly areas. What do you think, Katie?
Oh, look, I think we need to have plenty of green space, and I've got two little dogs, but we've got quite a few parks near our place, so it's not a real issue. But if we are going to be developing and there's plenty of high-density housing, especially when you talk about some of our major capital cities, then maybe it is something that we need to look at. I don't know if we only need dog parks or whether they should be parks for... I guess they're going to be... everybody's going to be welcome, but, you know, I know that I need more space for my children to run around as well.
Yeah, that is a big issue with families, isn't it? Because often little kids are scared of dogs, and if they're aggressive dogs, There's always this thing. Look, Brady, apparently in Melbourne, there's a new private play area has been unveiled for dogs, but owners have to pay to use it. I mean, do you think that's a solution?
Great idea. I mean, user pays, truly. We've got plenty of parks around. You can walk your dog around the streets, but I think it should be user pays. I mean, I'm not an independent witness here because I live near a dog park, and every Sunday from dawn to dusk, 100 or 200 dogs are barking non-stop.
Oh, really?
Stop.
Oh, okay.
And I've got to say, that's also used by the public as well. And even though the council puts the little poo bags there, there's poops all over the place. Mm. So I'm not an independent witness, and you can actually gather. I don't have a dog.
You're the perfect person to talk about this. And a popular restaurant strip in Melbourne is moving to ban delivery services like Uber Eats and Deliveroo to save the industry. They claim it's sending them broke and reducing the quality of their food. Katie, what do you reckon?
Would you believe we haven't actually had Uber Eats for very long here in the Northern Territory? And it was something that was raised as soon as it was introduced, basically, by a number of restaurants saying that it was going to have a huge negative impact on them in the sense that they were going to have to on-pass those costs, obviously, and that they didn't think the quality of food would be up to the same scratch that it is when you come in. Look, I think there's always going to be a demand for this delivery because, let's face it, we're all a little bit lazy and time poor, and it's much easier to get food delivered to your home than what it is to go out sometimes.
Yeah, Brady, do you think a ban on delivery services will help or hinder these businesses?
Look, I think a lot of these businesses are dropping out from what I read and what I see because they don't like the quality of the food that ends up at the house and they get a reputation for that. It's soggy, it's lukewarm, you know. And it is, as you say, it's laziness. We've got people here at Channel 9 in the won't go down to the canteen to eat the sumptuous meal in the Channel 9 canteen. They're ordering in all the time. My son the other night said, I got a freebie from one of the companies you mentioned. And I said, well, you won't be using that. And he said, no, I've got a bloke coming round to deliver a bag of chips from a 7-Eleven store.
No.
This poor man my age came late at night to deliver a $3 bag of chips from 7-Eleven. Yeah. He drove a car there and he went off. And I was so humiliated for this fellow. And I thought, well, there's about a tonne of carbon that went into the atmosphere to deliver a $3 bag of chips.
Because we've become lazy.
Yeah, you're right. I was actually filling up with petrol the other day. I was at the petrol station, an Uber Eats driver came in, and then they were delivering like a pack of lollies at a chocolate bar. And I was like, really? Do people even do that?
It's amazing.
I rarely use it because of the quality. I always find the stuff is soggy and revolting by the time it gets to me. So I'm happy to go out. Happy.
Absolutely. And you socialise more. You meet people.
Right?
You take an experience in. You know, absolutely.
Now, talking of lollies, Allens has launched a new range of lollies with 25% less sugar. But obesity experts say it's still not healthy, and it actually might confuse people into thinking it's okay to have them. Brady, a step in the right direction, or should people just stop eating lollies?
I say beauty. I can eat 25% more.
See, this is what they're
talking
about.
Share some with us, Brady.
People like
Uber
you.
Eats them to us.
We know they're not nutritional. We know they're not fantastic to eat. But gee whiz, let's not have the fun police crucifying a little bit of enjoyment in life. You know, 25%, great.
Can you save some of them for me later, please, Brady?
You got it.
Great.
I'll try.
Look, we do talk about the obesity crisis on a serious note. I mean, do you think Allens is at least trying to do the right thing, or is it just a marketing ploy to make people think they're eating better?
Well, I think it is just a bit of a marketing ploy to make them think they're eating better. At the end of the day, you're still buying a bag of lollies. And I'm always going to go for the full sugar lollies myself.
Are you? So you wouldn't be tempted if they're like, okay, a little bit less sugar.
Not really. I just think to myself, do you know what? If I'm going to buy a bag of lollies, I'm going to do it properly. And I'm going to buy the ones that I want.
I'm with you.
I didn't know that you were with us, Brady. I thought we'd lost you there to the sugar.
Nah. I'm going to be hell to be with this afternoon. I can tell you after all that.
Oh, I love it. Look, I don't mind the idea whether it's going to help the obesity crisis. Probably not, but at least it's providing alternatives.
It's heading in the right direction, you know? It's heading
in the right direction. Like, it's a nanny state. Again, why can't we all just be a little bit more cautious about what we eat rather than having to change everything?
On that note, Brady and Katie, we have to leave it there. Thank you so much for joining us.